sisters here, folks. Yay! Yay! Thank you so much for coming out on Valentine's Day. We're glad that you chose us. My name is Ben Fisher. I'm one of the people who's privileged to run Theater Pub along with Brian Markley, Stuart Bausell, and Julia Heidner. Is Julia here tonight?
No, she's not.
Rehearsal, sure. For those of you who are new to Theater Pub, we have new material every month of the year performed in the bar space, and also at, like, in April, the May 1X Festival. We have a play by one of our founding artists, Euripedes HELEN, Brain Kill, which is their opening in April. You will notice that you are in a bar, so while the show is happening around you, the bar is still functional, so please feel free to get up, grab a beer, use the restroom, but be cognizant of the fact that there will be actors wandering through the space. And then after the performance, which is about 70 minutes, we encourage you to hang out, talk to the artists and to the other friends and familia of Theater Pub, and find out about our future endeavors and ways to get involved. Without further ado, please enjoy Helen. Thank you.
Here live the lovely water nymphs of Nile, who brings the melted white snow down to water the plains of Egypt, starved of blessed rain. Proteus was king here when he lived, controlling all Egypt from his island home of Pharos. He married one of the sea nymphs, Psamathe, who'd left her husband, Icarus, and she bore him two children in this palace. First, a son, Theoclymenos, and then a young princess, the apple of her mother's eye, Theanoe. She had understanding of all things that are and are to come, prophetic powers. My own home country is pretty well known for its Sparta, and my father was Tyndareus. There's an old story that Zeus changed himself into a swan once, and chased by an eagle, took refuge in my mother Leda's lap, and by that trick took what he wanted from her, which may or may not be true. Now let me tell you my sad history. The three goddesses, Hera, Aphrodite, and Zeus-born Athena, the virgin Athena, went one day to Paris's valley hideout on Mount Ida, quarreling about their beauty and determined to have the issue judged. And Aphrodite offered my beauty, if anything can be called beautiful that brings misery, as a bribe, and me as a wife to Paris, and so won. Paris quitted his mountain herds and came to Sparta to collect his bride. But then Hera, disgruntled over her defeat, deprived her rival's solid promise of all substance. She gave the Trojan prince not the real me, but a living likeness conjured out of air, so that believing he possesses me, he possesses only his belief. All those years, the Helen who endured the siege of Troy, the Helen the Greek spears fought for as a prize, was me only in name. For I myself was wrapped in a cloud, hurried through pockets of air, and set down in the palace of Proteus here by Hermes. Proof that Zeus did not forget me. Indeed, he chose the most civilized of men to help me keep my marriage bed unstained. So here I've been, while my unhappy husband, bent on recovering me, mustered an army and sailed off to the battlements of Troy. Men died for me by thousands in Scamander, and I, the passive sufferer in it all, became anathema. For it seemed to the world that I had betrayed my husband, and that he had pushed Greece into a disastrous war. Then why do I go on living? For this reason, I have it on the authority of Hermes, that once my husband learns the truth, that never did I go to Troy, never was I unfaithful, I shall live with him again in famous Sparta. As long as the old King Proteus enjoyed life, I was immune from suitors. But his son, Theoclymenos, haunts me and hunts me. Which is why I've come, loyal to my vows to Menelaus, to the tomb of Proteus, as a suppliant for their preservations. Thus, at least, although my name is vilified all throughout Greece, my body here remains free from reproach.
Who is the lord of this imposing place? These royal precincts, this proud corniced mast, suggests the house of the god of wealth himself. Ah! Ye gods, what's this I see? An abomination! The very image of that murderous woman who was the ruin of me and all the Greeks! May the gods abhor you for resembling Helen.
Poor man, whoever you are, don't flinch away. Why detest me because of what happened to her?
My fault, my anger, got the better of me. For the whole of Greece loathes the daughter of Zeus. Forgive me, lady, for the words I spoke.
Well, who are you, though? Whereabouts do you come from?
I am one of the Greeks who fought and suffered.
No wonder you abominate Helen, then.
My name is Teucer. Telamon was my father. I was born and raised in Salamis.
What brings you then to the delta of the Nile?
I am an exile. I was driven from home.
You have my sympathy. Who was responsible?
The closest friend a man could have, my father.
But why? For the fact implies some sort of doom.
My brother Ajax died at Troy. My doom!
How? Well, you didn't kill him yourself, surely.
He died by his own hand, fell on his sword.
Was he mad then? No one sane attempts self-slaughter.
Have you heard of a certain Achilles, of Gilius' son?
He was one of Helen's suitors, so I've been told.
When he died, he left his arms to be contested.
And how could that have caused Ajax's death?
Another man won the arms, and he killed himself.
And so your troubles stem direct from his?
They do. In that I failed to die with him.
Did you really go to the famous city of Troy?
I brought about its downfall. And my own.
And is it razed flat now? Burnt to the ground?
So thoroughly that no trace of a wall is left.
Oh, Helen. Helen, for you the Trojans perished.
The Trojans? The Greeks too? A holocaust!
How long is it since the city was destroyed?
You don't know, man! You weren't there! Almost seven harvests have gone round since then.
And before that, how long were you at Troy?
Innumerable months, 10 years in all.
Tell me, did you capture the Spartan woman?
Menelaus did, and dragged her off by the hair.
Did you see the unhappy queen, or is this hearsay?
I saw her as plainly as I'm seeing you.
But perhaps the gods made you imagine it all.
Please! Talk of something else. Stop harping on her.
And is Menelaus now with his wife?
He's certainly not in Argos, nor in Sparta.
That is terrible news. For some who hear it, anyway.
He's said to have vanished, lost, and his wife with him.
But surely all the Greeks sailed back together.
Well, they did. But a storm scattered them far apart.
Where were they on the wide salt sea when it struck?
Halfway through their passage of the Aegean.
And no one's had news of him since landing?
No one. All Greece considers him as dead.
I am crushed. And Theseus' daughter, is she living?
Leda, you mean? No. She died. Long ago.
You're not suggesting Helen's disgrace destroyed her?
They say so. Though she was royal, she hanged herself.
And her sons, Castor and Polydeucus, dead or alive?
Both, you might say. There are two different rumors.
Give me the stronger one.
Instead, they became gods in the shape of stars.
Oh, those words are welcome. But what's the other story?
That shame for their sister made them end their lives on their own swords. But enough of tales of the past. I've no desire for a second bout of tears. My reason for arriving at this place is to see the prophetess, Theanoe. Will you introduce me so that I can ask advice from the oracle how best to obtain a fair wind for my voyage onto Cyprus?
The ship and the sea will guide you there themselves. But sir, make your getaway from this place before Theoclymenos sees you. He's the king, and any Greek caught here he puts to death. Don't press me to know why. I'm saying nothing. And anyway, what good could the knowledge do you?
Kind and frank words, which I appreciate, lady. May the gods reward you richly in return. Your similarity to Helen is only skin deep. Inside, you're not a bit like her. May she die horribly and never reach home. But as for you, good luck.
Women of Greece, captives of a foreign war, I have news for your ears. A Greek mariner has come ashore, bringing fresh tears to mingle with my tears. Troy is a smoking ruin of war, destroyed by my deadly face, or rather by my ill-used name. Leda, my mother, has put a noose around her neck for shame. My wandering sea-tossed husband is lost. Is lost. Aww. And Sparta's glory and pride, Castor and his twin-born brother will never be seen again.
Mourn, mourn, for Helen pounded by her doom.
You were given a mocking gift, a life not to be born, when Zeus swooped down from mid-heaven in the shape of a swan, and with a flash of snow-white wings planted you in your mother's womb.
Since then, what sufferings, what trials have you not undergone?
Leda is dead. Your two brothers, the beloved sons of Zeus, are far away from happiness.
Your land of birth is hidden from your eyes.
Throughout the cities of Greece, there runs a rumor, lady, that implies you sleep in a barbarian's embrace.
Your lord is a corpse on the sea's bed. Never again will you bless your father's house.
Alas, whose hand in the known world felled that pine that ultimately spelled ruin to Troy? For from that tree was nailed and hammered the ship that Paris sailed with his pirate oarsmen over the waves to shatter this piece of my hearth in his quest for the prize of my lovely disastrous eyes and the pleasures of my marriage bed. And with him, false to all she'd said, came the murderous goddess of love who sent to their graves the warriors of both Troy and Greece. And then her highness Hera, who shares the bed of Zeus and on a gold throne sits beside him, sent her message bearer, the swift-footed son of Maia, down. He caught me when I was gathering fresh roses in my gown to take to Athena's temple, snatched me and brought me through the glittering zone of air to this bleak shore, where I became a wretched prize in the fierce tug of war between all Greece and Priam's sons. And now where the river Simois runs, I'm soiled with a false shame that's mine only in name. Only in name.
You have sorrow enough, we know. But one must bear the burdens of life as lightly as one can.
Was I not born a monster? My entire life, every wretched event, has been unnatural, for which I blame my beauty as much as Hera. If only it could have been wiped clean like a picture so that the Greeks, forgetting the blemishes that chance has put upon me, might bear in mind my better, not my worse side, as they do. When a person's hopes hang on a single issue and the gods treat him badly, then it's hard, but it's still bearable. But in my case, misfortunes hem me in from all directions. And the sole anchor in my sea of troubles, the hope that my husband would arrive one day and rescue me, he's gone, or he's gone too. Dead. And my mother's dead, and I destroyed her. Untrue, unjust, but injustice sticks. Dead are my two twin brothers, whom they call the sons of Zeus, and dead is my own heart through what's been done to me, though I live on. This is the doom and depth of my despair. The very beauty that makes other women happy has proved for me a blasting curse.
Helen, don't be too sure that what that Greek, whoever he is, reported is all true.
But he made it clear enough that my husband's dead.
The spoken word can often turn out false.
But equally, it can have the ring of truth.
You're biased towards the dark view, not the bright.
It's fear that grips me and drives me into fear.
How much goodwill do you have inside the palace?
Well, they're all my friends, except my hot pursuer.
Do you know what you must do now? Leave this sanctuary.
What are you trying to say? What is your proposal?
And go to the house of the daughter of the sea, the Nereid Theonoe, who knows all things. Ask her whether your husband's still alive, enjoying daylight. When you've got your answer, weep and rejoice according to the news. But what good can it do you to grieve now? Before you know the facts, listen to me. I'm willing to accompany you myself to ask her for your clairvoyant revelation. Women should always give each other help.
Friends, I shall do what you say. Hurry to the palace, hurry through the gate to learn the outcome of my fate.
You call me?
Gladly I go.
Ay, black day, what words of horror or unhappiness am I about to hear?
Dear heart, don't leap ahead of your fear.
Don't play the prophetess to your own low.
What deep distress has my husband suffered? Does he see the sun chariot his four horses and the stars run on their nightly courses? Or does he share the dead man's doom below?
Accept the future, whatever face it may wear, as a friend.
Eurotas, my home river, sweet running and reed green, to you I appeal, be my witness. If the report is true that my husband's dead, I swear I shall end!
What do these wild words mean?
I shall pay the price of my guilt with my life. Noose my neck with a strangling rope, or use the bloody throat-severing knife till the sharp, cold thrust of steel and the flesh's cruel ordeal make of my death a sacrifice. To the three goddesses and Priam's boy, who once had herds and tuned his pipe on Idas.
May bad luck shift elsewhere and leave you home.
Oh, grandfather Pelops,
who at Pisa once won the great chariot race with Onomaus.
If that your life had ended the same day you were served up a banquet for the gods. Instead, revived by them, you lived to father Atreus, who in turn with Europe produced that famous couple, Agamemnon and myself, Menelaus. I consider, and I don't say this to boast, that of the Greeks, I shipped the largest expeditionary force to Troy, and my authority as king owed nothing to compulsion, being based on willing obedience from the men I led. The count of those who died and those who escaped the perils at sea and got back safely with the names of all the dead can now be reckoned exactly. I'm the exception, for ever since I sacked the towers of Troy, I've been a miserable wanderer on the gray-green rolling seas, longing for my own country, which it seems the gods think I'm unworthy to rejoin. I've sailed to every lonely landing place and hostile port in Libya. Every time I near my native shores, gales beat me back. Not once have I had the wind I need for home, and now I'm here, a wretched castaway. My comrades lost, our ships split on the rocks and smashed the flotsam. Washed up on this coast, I found a floating keel, all that was left, in which my desperate danger with great difficulty, I got to land, saving Helen as well, my prize from Troy. Who the inhabitants are, or what this place is called, I don't have the slightest bit. Out of embarrassment, I avoided the crowd, and so I never ask. And concealing my distress, ashamed at my shabby state, and for when a man of high importance falls on evil times, he feels it more than one inured to hardship because it's unfamiliar.
I'm in fact at the end of my tether. No food, no clothes to cover me, as anyone can tell. For the sea has confiscated my magnificent and luxurious wardrobe. Meanwhile, having hidden the cause of all my sufferings, my wife in the depths of a cave, and charged my fellow survivors with the task of guarding her, I've come on my own and tried to scourge and scrounge provisions for my shipmates. When I saw these high-topped walls and grand gates, I thought, some rich man's mansion. And approached, since there's always hope in the houses of the wealthy for sailors in need. From the poor, they can't get help, even though the will to give it may be there. Hello there! Hello there! Is there a porter to take the news of my predicament inside?
Who's this at the door? Be gone with you at once! Stop hanging about the porch and bothering me lords and masters, or you'll end up dead! Greek! We've no truck! With Greeks!
Well said, old lady! A fine speech! Alright, I'll behave myself. Only less temper, please.
Be off with you, I tell you! Stranger, I've strict orders not to let anyone inside this house.
Look here, don't wave your arms and jostle me.
It's your fault not doing what I say.
Go announce to your master that I'm here.
I won't be so popular if I do.
As a shipwrecked foreigner, I'm a protected person.
Off with you now. Try another house.
I shan't. I'm coming in. Do as I order.
You're a nuisance, you know. You get thrown out.
Where's my famous army now? I need them.
You may have been somebody elsewhere. Boy, you're nobody! Catch a cold.
So, do we deserve this? What an insult!
Tears in your eyes, eh? Who are you mourning to?
Only happy days I used to know!
Happy days, and go dump your tears on your old friends!
What country am I in? Whose palace is this?
Proteus, you're in Egypt.
Egypt? So it's an ill wind that blew me here.
What have you got against our shining Nile?
Oh, nothing at all. It's only my luck I'm cursing.
Plenty of folk have trouble, you know. Colonel.
Your king, whatever you call him, is he at home?
Your tomb, you see, is his. His son reigns now.
Then where is he? He's at the house away.
Not at home. And he's a hater of all things Greek. The daughter of Zeus. She's here in this palace.
What? Did I hear you rightly? Say that again.
Tyndareus' daughter, the one who lived in Sparta.
Where did she come from?
From Sparta, of course! I'm going to trick you, coward!
outside the palace have taken a pretty bad time just now. You've come at a bad time. If my royal master catches you here, your welcome will be death. But, you know, I'm a friend of the Greeks more than my words let on. If I spoke harshly, it was only for the fear of hell. So never mind. I'll fight someone like you.
I'm at a loss.
Tells me a new disaster is following in the train of the old ones. If I really seized my wife in Troy and brought her here with me to put me under guard in a cave, there must be another woman bearing the same name who's in the house. She called her the daughter of Zeus. Is there a man by the name of Zeus living beside the Nile? There's only one Zeus, the one in heaven. And where else in the world can there be a Spartan? Except beside the reed-bright, rippling Eurotas. Tyndareus is a unique and well-known name. Can there possibly be a second Sparta and another Troy? I don't know what to make of it. But the Earth's a big place, I suppose. I suppose many things must have the same names. Cities and women, too. There's nothing strange in that.
Now, back to my station at the sanctuary. Having heard Thenue's welcome revelation, she knows the truth of all things, and she says that my husband is alive, lives, sees the daylight, that having weathered countless passages, no novice in the school of travel, and after wandering about the world, he'll find at last the appointed end of all sufferings. Here! Oh, but one thing she didn't mention. When he arrives, will he be spared? For overjoyed hearing that he lived, I failed to press home the question. She also said that he's escaped a shipwreck with a few friends, and at this very moment is somewhere near. Oh, dear husband, when will you come? And if you come, what a void in my heart you'll fill.
Stop! Don't run away. When you revealed your face, it struck me speechless with astonishment. I'm not a bandit or a hired abductor. Don't be afraid. Lady, who are you? Whose face am I looking at?
And who are you? Our questions are the same.
I never in my life saw such resemblances. Are you a Greek or a native of this country?
A Greek. And you? I long to know as well.
Lady, you look uncannily like Helen.
And you like Menelaus. What does it mean?
The truth? I am the most unhappy man.
Oh, long-lost husband, come to your wife's arms!
What do you mean, wife?
The wife that Tyndareus, my father, gave you.
Hecate, send me kinder visions.
I am no moonlight ghost of the crossways goddess.
No more than I am the husband of two women.
Who is this other woman whose lord you are?
The wife I brought from Troy to hide in the cave.
I am your wife. You have no other queen.
My mind is clear enough, but are my eyes?
Yes, for surely you recognize your wife.
You look like her, indeed. I won't deny it.
Whom should you trust for proof, if not your eyes?
They fail me here. I have another wife.
But I never went to Troy. That was a phantom.
Come. Who on earth can make living likenesses?
She was formed of air by the gods to be your bride.
And which god modeled her? That's a past belief.
Hera, in order to palm her off on Paris.
You were here, then, and in Troy. At the same time.
A name can travel where a body cannot.
Let me alone. I've had troubles enough before.
Will you leave me then? And go with your shadow wife?
Yes. Farewell. Good luck, since you're like Helen.
These words destroy me. A husband found and lost. Alas, was ever a woman so unhappy?
Menelaus! I have been wandering all over this barbarous country looking for you, sent by the men you left. Finding you has been hard work.
What's happened?
A weird thing. What words pale beside the fact? The hardships you endured were all for nothing.
What's new?
Your wife's gone. She vanished. She was spirited away out of the special cave which we were guarding into the folds of the air, some hiding place into the sky. Before she went, she just said this. Encore, long-suffering Trojans and all you Greeks who fought at Troy. It was because of me that you died at Scamander's base, as Hera planned, imagining Paris had Helen in his bed. When he never did. The time arrived for me, having done my duty, here as fate ordained, to return my father to the sky. I pity Helen, daughter of Tyndareus, who's heard her name baselessly slandered, though she's innocent. Greetings, daughter of Leda. So you've been here. I've just reported that you've disappeared into starry space, being quite unaware. That you've sprouted wings. Next time, I shan't allow you to fool us with another trick like this. You gave your husband and his followers more than their fill of trouble over Troy.
Last, the answer. It all fits together. What she said is true. A dearly longed for day that brings me to your arms in my close embrace.
Menelaus, dearest of men, our time of waiting has grown gray and old, but our joy now is fresh and bright. When I have my husband again to cherish and to hold. After long feelings of the sun, oh, bringer of daily light, in our rapture I clasp my beloved one.
I found you. Since we've been apart, there's been so much to tell between us. Where should we start?
For the joy, the hairs on my head rise and shiver. For joy, I shed tears, and for joy, I wind my arms around your body fast. Happy, oh dearest husband, happy at last.
Oh, precious face, you have no fault to find, oh. The daughter of Zeus is in Lydia's bed, is mine. She whom the twin brothers who rode white horses brought me as a bride with double blessings under the shine of torches on that long ago day. And now the god who stole you away from me in my house is leading us on to better things. The dark times are gone.
Lucky misfortune, husband, has brought us together after a long, long storm. But now that it's fair, I pray to enjoy the weather.
May you enjoy it. I repeat your prayer. With two like us, who must share, joy and sorrow cannot be separated.
Dear good friends, I no longer regret the past or begrudge its misery. I have my husband. He belongs to me. After the many years I waited. Oh, how I waited for him to return from Troy.
I am yours, you are mine. We have each other again. Having watched thousands of sad sunsets. In my delusion, only now I can guess Hera's design. But now the tears are of joy. Now I have far more happiness than I ever had pain.
What can I say? Who could ever have hoped for such unhoped for bliss? To hold you in my arms like this.
As I hold you. You, who I thought had eloped.
I never ran away to seek that foreign prince's bed of shame. Hurried away by oars, carried away by lust.
What god in power there bore you like a prize from your own land?
Oh, husband, it was the son of Zeus, Hermes, who came, decoyed me, and brought me to the Nile.
Incredible. At whose command? This tale is too wild to understand.
I have wept and wept, and my eyes are wet with tears still. The wife of Zeus destroyed me. Cruel indeed. And so she brought me here to Egypt. Accursed and star-crossed, I was robbed by Hera of my country, bereft of city and friends. Above all, I lost you. On the day I left your home and bed. And all for a lie, for it was only my name that earned me an adulteress's shame.
Menelaus, let me deeper into your joy, which I glimpse, but don't yet fully understand. But isn't this the lady who presided over the agony of the men at Troy?
No, we were tricked by the gods. Helen was seized, and only a mischievous phantom made of air.
What? All that pain endured for a mere ghost?
That was the work of Helen and her rivals.
And so this lady here is your real wife?
She is. I say so. Take my word for it.
Daughter, the ways of God are intricate and hard to fathom, but with a curious wisdom, he disarranges everything to make new patterns. Some attempt and strive and fail, others effortlessly prosper, then one day run into ruin, for no man is certain of holding fortune steady in his hands. You and your husband have had more than your share of suffering. You had to stand against a storm of words, and he a storm of spears. But when he fought, hard, he won nothing. And yet, now, happiness is of his own accord. And yet, you never showed shame of your aged father and your divine twin brothers, nor did you do what the world said you did. In my mind's eye, I can see the day of your marriage. I remember waving a torch and running beside the wheels of the four yoked horses when you were a bride being charioted by your husband Menelaus, from your grand house.
Oh, fellow soldier, who with your shield and spear have done your stint of hardship in my service and are now due for a ration of my luck. Go and report to the friends I left behind our situation as you see it, the ticklish corner we're in. Tell them to go to shore and wait in readiness for the trial of strength I can see coming. Keep alert to find some means of rescuing my wife and escaping the barbarians if we can.
It shall be done, my lord.
Well then, so far, so good. But now, my poor husband, tell me how you've survived since Troy. How long did you wander, driven over the seas back?
It's been 10 years at Troy. Add on to those 7 summers and 7 winters voyaging.
Long, grim time for you. And you've escaped and reached here only to be faced with death.
Death?
Well,
do you mean? You chill my bones.
The master of this place means to kill you.
What have I done to deserve to lose my life?
Your surprise puts a stop to our wedding.
What? Well, yes. Somebody here is trying to marry my wife?
Yes, and to take me by force.
What?
I had to bear it.
What force? His own, or has he royal power?
He is the ruler here, the son of Proteus.
So that is what that old woman at the door meant.
What doors have you been knocking in at, Agent?
These doors. And I was chased off like a beggar.
I'm not asking for charity.
Oh!
I feel the shame.
It amounted to that, though the word wasn't used.
Evidently, you know the whole story.
I do. What I don't know is how far you've foiled them.
Then learn. My body's been kept chaste for you.
But how can I be sure? Sweet news are true.
You see this tomb? The seat of my despair? I sit there praying to escape this marriage. I've been as safe as in our own God's temples.
Then I can't bring you aboard the ship and sail for home.
You'd be nearer to your grave than to my bed.
And so the most unhappy man alive.
Escape and save yourself. Well, don't be ashamed.
And you leave you. When I sacked Troy for your sake.
Better than that, my love should cause your death.
Cowardly advice to a veteran of Troy.
I suppose you want to kill the king.
And why not?
You couldn't.
And why not? Is he weapon proof?
You'll see. To attempt the impossible is folly.
So meekly I hold both hands out to be bound.
Well, you're cornered. We must think of some way to get out.
I'd rather be killed in action than die tamely of some kind.
There's just one hope for us. A single chance.
Persuasion? Bribery? Or a stroke of daring?
If the king never learns of your arrival,
who's going to tell him? Even know my name?
He has an ally inside with the power of a god.
You mean there's some private oracle in this palace?
I mean his sister, whom they call Fenway.
That's an oracular sounding name. What does she do?
She knows all things. She'll tell her brother you're here.
And I shall be killed. I have no way of hiding.
But if we both appeal to her as suppliants.
To do what? What hope are we leading up to?
Not to inform her brother of your presence.
If we won her over, could we get away?
With her help? Easily? In secret? No.
That's your task. Woman to woman's the best way.
I'll get to her and clasp her knees, I promise.
But wait, what if she's deaf to our appeals?
You... How about that kind of an ending? You die. And I am forced miserably to marry.
Betrayal. The word forced is a mere excuse.
No! Forced.
Sworn.
For I've solemnly sworn by your head.
Sworn what? To die? Never to swerve in love?
To die by the same sword as you. And lie by you.
Oh. Seal that pledge. Hold my right hand in yours.
I do. And swear. If you die, I died also.
And I, if I lose you, shall take my life.
How can we make an honorable ending?
Here on this tomb, I'll kill you, then myself, but first I'll put up an almighty struggle. For you and your marriage, let who dares come near. I won't dishonor the name of Troy, nor go back home to Greece with that great blot on my reputation. I was responsible for Thetis longing and losing Achilles. I saw Ajax bleed on his own sword. I was there when Nestor was left without a son. And am I the man, then, to count my wife not worth the price of death? Not I. If there are gods above and wise ones, then let the earth lie lightly on the brave man slain by his enemies, but the corpse of a coward they cast unburied on some barren reef.
Dear heaven, may the house of Tantalus be happy at last and freed of all its sorrows.
Misery. Bad luck dogs us still. Menelaus, we are trapped. Then away, the prophetess is coming. I can hear the sound of the door. The door's being unbarred. Fly! Oh, well, what good will that do? Whether she's here or somewhere else, she can divine your presence.
Helen! What do you think of my prophecies now?
Without his ships, without his phantom wife, Menelaus manifestly stands before you.
Unhappy man.
To escape so many dangers, only to end up here, without even knowing which it's to be. Sweet home, bitter Egypt. This day, the Assembly of the Gods will argue your case in the court of Zeus. Your old foe Hera is now your friend, and wants to bring about a safe return for you and Helen with you. That Greece may learn how Aphrodite's gift to Paris was no gift, his bride no bride. But Aphrodite wants to foil your journey, that the world may never know that when she purchased the beauty prize, she paid for it in false coin. It lies in my power either to destroy you, as Aphrodite hopes, by telling my brother of your arrival, or to side with Hera and save your life by keeping it dark from him.
May I fall to the ground in supplication and clasp your knees, and in this humble posture, for my sake and this man's, whom at long last having won back, I'm in immediate danger of losing again, ask you to spare us. Now that my husband's found my loving arms, save him. I beg you, don't inform your brother. For that will happen then too! Neighbor. Although I've suffered in Egypt, in the end it's proved a blessed chance that Hermes gave me to be your father, to be kept safe from my husband, who stands here eager to reclaim his own. Well, how can he if he's dead? And how could Proteus pay what he owes a live woman to a corpse? Huh? Consider the contract between man and God. Well, wouldn't both Hermes what's rightfully one man's to be given back? I know they would. You mustn't give more weight to a wild brother than an upright father. You're a seer. You believe in the gods. How can you then break your father's just commitment to keep the bad law of a lawless brother? Shame! To be privy of the thoughts of fate, present and future, and not know what's wrong? You see me dogged by misery, ringed by danger. Save us. Bestow this extra grace of fortune. For the whole world hates Helen. All Greece knows me as the wife who deceived her husband and eloped to live in the golden mansions of the East. But if I get back to Greece and Sparta again, if they hear and see the truth, that they were ruined by the trick of a god, that I never betrayed my loves, they'll restore me to my good name. If Menelaus had been killed abroad, I should have rendered my service to the dead with loving tears in his absence. He's here. He's alive. STV taken from you. No, prophetess. As a suppliant, I implore you, grant me this favor, and in so doing, follow your noble father's footsteps, for the child of a fine man can win no greater glory than matching the example of his life.
The words you've spoken, and you yourself still more, arouse my pity. But how would Menelaus argue to save his life? I long to hear.
I cannot bring myself to fall to the ground and hug your knees and let those floods of tears, such abject, weak behavior would disgrace the memory of Troy. And yet they say, the high warm men in deep distress have wept without dishonor. All the same, I spurn the doubt, that doubtful style of manhood. I choose courage. It seems right to you to save a stranger, that what's more, a man attempting to reclaim his rightful wife. Then give her back to me and help us to escape. If not, I won't be first to grieve the grief I've endured, or the last either. But you will be seen, an evil woman. If you and your brother steal my wife from me, I'll tell you, as if she failed to, what will happen. Prophetess, you should know we're bound to oath. I've vowed to fight your brother to the death. It's him or me. That's all there is to it. If he won't meet me man to man and tries to trap and starve us in our sanctuary, I've sworn to first kill Helen and then thrust this two-edged sword into my heart on the grave slab of Proteus here till the gushing blood drips down, and so we'll lie, two corpses side by side on the marble monument to torment your conscience forever and pollute your father's name. Never your brother nor any other man alive is going to marry her. I shall take her with me home if I can, and if not, to the dead.
Maiden, it rests with you to judge the case. Judge it so that all of us here feel pleased.
By nature and vocation, I love piety. I cherish myself. And I would never sully my father's name or do my brother a favor at the cost of my own dishonor. In my heart, there's a great shrine of justice. I inherit it from my father, my grandfather, Nereus, and Menelaus. I mean to keep it holy all my life. Since Hera wants to aid you, I shall cast my vote with Hera's. As for Aphrodite, may love be not offended. She's never been a friend of mine, but I propose to stay a virgin all my life. The reproach you aimed at my father by this tune hits me as well. Not to repay would be wrong. Were he alive, I know he would restore you to each other. For all the world, the dead as well as the living, agrees that good and evil are rewarded. The dead may not have living minds like ours, but having once mixed with immortal ether, they have immortal consciousness. Therefore, not to prolong my speech.
So late!
I shall keep silence on the subject of your plea. I shall not become an accomplice to my brother's wicked folly. Indeed, however it may seem to the world, in trying to steer him from impiety to godliness, I'm doing him a service. As for escape, you must find a way yourselves. I'll stand aside aloof and hold my tongue. Begin with the gods. First, pray to Aphrodite to allow you a safe journey home, and then ask Hera to stay constant to you both in her goodwill, for it's that on which deliverance hangs. Oh, my dead father, well, there's strength in me. Your sacred memory shall not be profaned.
The wicked never prosper in their ways. Our hope of safety lies in doing right.
We're safe as far as she's concerned, Menelaus. As for the rest, you must come up with a plan by which we can effect our joint escape.
You've been here a long time, right? Listen to me. You've grown familiar with the palace servants.
Why do you ask? You seem to raise the hope of doing something positive to help us.
Could you persuade one of the grooms in charge of the four-horse chariots to give us one?
I could, but how can we escape by land over the huge, unknown Egyptian plains?
You're right. Well then, I'll hide in the palace and kill the king with this sword and... What do you say?
Anyway, I wouldn't sanction that. She'd break her silence rather than let you kill her brother.
What's more, we haven't even got a ship in our... for our flight. The sea has claimed the one I had.
Listen. A woman can plan wisely, too. Will you let me, as a ruse, report you dead?
Ominous word. But if I'll be the gainer, I'm willing to be called dead when I'm not.
Good. Then I'll act the woman's part. With dirges and a shaved head for the irreligious king.
But how will this trick help our combined escape? It's a rather old-fashioned one, you know.
I'll tell him you were drowned at sea and ask him for permission to erect a monument.
Suppose he agrees. How can we save ourselves with an empty tomb when we haven't got a ship?
I'll insist on a ship so that your robes and jewels can duly be consigned to the sea's hands.
Perfect. Except one thing. If he orders a ceremony on land, your pretext fails.
But I'll make it out that it isn't the Greek custom to bury ashore those who were lost at sea.
Another good idea. And I shall join you on board the ship to help you with the ritual.
Well, of course you must. You above all. And with you, those of your sailors who survived the wreck.
Once I have a ship at anchor, I have my men in bark, armed with their swords and in fighting order.
Okay, you must arrange all that. I'll simply pray for favorable winds.
I shall.
Let the ship run.
I shall. The gods are about to end our troubles, but who will you say told you that I was dead?
You! I'll pretend you were the sole survivor of Menelaus' crew and saw him drown. Yes.
These rags and the sail I've got wrapped around me will lend to the color of the story of the wreck.
They're handy now. Your clothes were a sad loss, then. That ill wind could still blow us some good.
Shall I go indoors with you, or would it be better to sit here quietly beside the tomb?
Stay here. If he resorts to viciousness, the tomb, as well as your own sword, will protect you. Meanwhile, I'll enter the palace, cut my hair off, change this orange robe for mourning black, then scratch my cheeks with my nails till the skin shows blood. For now, everything.
Everything hangs in the balance. The scales must tilt one way or the other as I see it. Either I die caught out in my deception, or else we reach home. And I've saved your life!
What is God? What is nugget?
What lies in between man and God?
Who on this earth, at dissection, can claim to have been to the end of that question's torturous flame?
For every man has seen the plans of God lurching here and there and back again in unexpected and absurd vicissitudes.
Oh, Helen! You were conceived in Leda's womb by Zeus' wing like a bird.
Yet from the rooftops of Greece you have been proclaimed a wicked woman who deceived a husband, shamed honor, and erred against the laws of God and man.
Discover who can. Certainty in the utterance of mankind.
For myself, I find truth only in God's word.
Madam, madmen, all who seek glory in war, trusting in ignorance to the sheer weight of the lance to end mortal debate.
If battle and blood have settled the score, grief and hate will never leave the cities of men.
Through strife, such men have found cramped sleeping room, a Trojan burial mound, who might by words have learned some way to compound the quarrel over Menelaus' wife.
You, Helen!
Now they lie in the domain of the god of death, and pouncing fire has burnt as if Zeus had hurled his bolt those walls to the ground, while you endure a pitiable life of pain. Ugh,